Welcome to the Hadley Historical House. I'm Rosalie Weinberg. I'm on the program committee for the Hadley Historical Society. And I'd like to welcome my cousin. Steve Bob's going to talk about farming today in Hadley.
We keep this all in the family.
I'm
going to
talk about the farm that I grew up on. Okay. Allan, the housekeeper.
Pretty much, I'm telling the story of farming in Hadley by illustrating it with my farm. So I'm going to talk mostly about what's happening on my farm, but it's in the larger context of what's going on around me. Now, I know a lot of you. I kind of like to know my audience when I'm speaking. I don't know all of you, so help me out here with raising hands in case you fit these categories. Is anyone here currently active in the Environmental Protection Agency? About the Pesticide Bureau. Labor Board. Department of Immigration. Internal Revenue Service. Okay. I have some notes here because even though I know about my farm, I had to organize the information. But I actually wrote two talks for tonight. One was fake news and alternative facts. The other was the real story, and since this is a safe crowd, we'll tell the real story, all right? I'd like to start with a little bit about the historical character of my farm. I'm going to use a certain definition of farm in the context of this talk. Let's go back to 1659 when Hadley was established. What was a farm? Well, the surveyors came upriver before the settlers came, and they laid out stakes with a home lot, roughly 8 acres, 10 acres, abutting West Street. There was a house put on that, barns. The farmer and his family lived there. They farmed the field right out back, then they had parcels in the different meadows. That's the definition I want to use, and it's significant. My farm retains that original structure. A lot of the farms up and down West Street were subdivided. We were left entire. The house isn't from 1659. We've got 1790, and then the L is much earlier. But the significance of this is, what's my farm? Is it something my parents started or grandparents? Yes, in a sense, no, in a sense. It's a farm that started right at the beginning of the town. And the way I look at it is each of us who own and operate it really only have a tenure there. We started way back, and it's just handed on, hand after hand, generation after generation. Well, the Zuchowski tenure started in 1905, 112 years ago. So the little pamphlet advertising the talk tonight is incorrect. It's not a 100-year-old farm. It's a 112-year-old farm. My grandparents, Alexander Zuchowski and his wife Helena, they immigrated from Poland. Now, I'm not exactly sure when my grandfather came here. My grandmother came in 1901, I'm sure of that. My grandfather came before that. But they came from actually what's called Russia, Poland. Poland had been partitioned in the 1700s between Russia, Austria, and Germany. And our family were in the Eastern partition under the Tsars. So my grandfather, grandmother got the thing going and farmed it with their seven children for many years. Now what was it like? Well, you know, there's a lot of folks here who had grandparents back then, and I know you know what the farms were like, so ours was typical of all the others. It's what I kind of like to call self-sufficient with cash crops. Cows, pigs, chickens, horses. I mean, these people didn't have the grocery purchases that even a farm like mine does today. They grew most of what they ate. Then they grew some cash crops. And you know, Hadley, like any other small town, it's sort of a monkey see, monkey do. Somebody starts it and everybody else jumps on the bandwagon. So I don't know exactly who started it, but my grandfather grew onions, tobacco, asparagus. Those were the major cash crops in the day. Then of course there was the hay and the corn for the animals. I think back and I'm very grateful to my grandparents, the toil, the labor, the effort, the diligence they put in. And that's everybody's story in this room who had immigrant grandparents or whatever that started farms. And it's also true of our quote, end quote, Yankee neighbors who were here long before us. Those folks worked hard. They weren't looking for handouts. They weren't looking to shirk hard work. That work ethic and discipline is what made America great. My father used to like to reminisce old times. He would tell me stories about what he remembered as a child, how the old folks worked. He said that, you know, they grew onions like all the neighbors. If you remember, they would pull the onions, lay them in rows in the field, kind of like shingles lapping on a roof. Then you kind of went on your hands and knees with clippers and clipped the tops off. He remembers as a child his older sisters doing the babysitting, and his parents were out there into the night under lantern light clipping onions. My grandfather in the winter had his farm chores with the animals, but he would get up early, take care of all the livestock in the barn, have a breakfast. He'd walk down West Street, walk across the frozen river, across Hatfield Meadow, sort tobacco all day in Hatfield. Return the same way, go do the chores, go to bed and do it all again next day. I can't tell you how much I appreciate what those who went before me did for me. There was a really interesting old world practice that was still current in Hadley in my grandparents' time, and my grandfather was central to it. I'm going to use the Russian term because I don't know it in any of the other Eastern European languages. It's called mir. And what it literally means is world. And my father told me when he was a child, he remembers that that original generation that came over and established our farm and the neighboring ones, they carried over an old world practice. Back in the old country, as you approach spring, the village farmers would get together, gather at someone's house, and talk over the coming season. And they did that at my house. I don't know how long that practice continued, but they did the old world mir at our place. And so there was still sort of a cooperative, collective mentality in those days, which is kind of amazing because, well, I kind of hate to say it, but one of the characteristics of Polish farmers were very, very competitive. You know, there's an old joke. If you granted a Polish farmer one wish, what would it be? Answer, that his neighbor's horse dies. So here you have this competitive spirited people following the old cooperative mirror. You figure it out. Well, I think, you know, the nature of farms, like life in general, there's going to be changes and innovations. In my grandparents' time, they saw some really big changes. First of all, they got electricity. When my grandfather took over the house in 1906, he occupied it, there was no electricity, and the same in the neighbors. My father told a childhood story. I don't know what year they got the electricity, but my father was a little boy. And he said the folks had the electricians come and wire the place. Then the family gathered, and the electrician flipped the switch, and the light went on. And my father said he jumped up and down and clapped his hands, went, yay, yay. His older sisters were terribly embarrassed of this display by the hick from the sticks. Somewhere prior to World War II, the farm got a truck. Prior to that, Grandpa had to hitch up the horses to the wagon and go everywhere and do his business. Then there was a big change on the farm. 1943, my grandfather got a contract with Westover Air Force Base to grow potatoes. And so now they needed a tractor. So they got a Farmall H. You know, this sounds funny, a truck, electricity, a tractor. We take it all for granted. But you know, the generation since then, we've seen a lot of changes and innovations. But I honestly think that generation saw the most dramatic changes. Think about it. These people went from lanterns and horses to electricity and motor vehicles. I haven't seen a change like that in my life. The way I like to kind of tell it with a little hyperbole, my grandparents went all the way from the medieval Russia of the Tsars to the modern world. Oh, there is one funny story characterizing the times. You know, people have told me stories in this town all my life because they knew I was interested in history. And I wish now that I kind of started back then with a notebook and wrote it down. I do remember things. I'm sure I've forgotten many. I don't know who told me the story, but it's a good one. There was the 1936 and 38 floods, so now I don't know which flood it was, but it was one of those two. And West Streeters were evacuated as refugees up to the town hall. And some old-timer told me, you know what, I remember your grandmother walked a cow to the town hall so that the flood refugees could have milk. Now, you know, think today if we had a big emergency today with people evacuated and temporarily brought to the town hall, you can see it. Vehicles with flashing lights. I mean, if there was any food at all, it'd be in plastic bottles and cans and all that. Well, in that day, they brought a cow to the town hall. You know, if we had an emergency today and maybe the Barstools or Art West brought a cow to the town hall, nobody knew how to milk it. I mean, milk comes from the supermarket. Okay, so my father's tenure on the farm started in 1946 when his father passed away. And initially he carried on the same crops. Asparagus, tobacco, onions. The onions kind of dropped out soon, and I'm so happy they did. Potatoes, he did potatoes. But then he started his own innovations. A lot of different equipment on the farm now. More tractors, different sizes, mechanical planters, crop sprayer, crop duster. Right? We're seeing changes in the environment, changes in the equipment. And my father tried some different crops, not so typical of the farms around here. He did some eggplant under plastic, he did cantaloupes, just branching out the stuff that we didn't typically do on these farms. But then there was a real significant crop he started back, don't know the exact year, but it was the early 1950s, butternut squash. And the story he told me is, there was a farmer named McNiff, I don't even know the man's first name, but I think he operated out on Honey Pot where Al McKinstry is, all right, now. And he started butternut. And my father's brother-in-law, John Dzinski, somehow connected with McNiff and learned the trade, and then my father learned it from his uncle Jack. And this is very significant because I don't know, you know, if someone in their garden had grown butternut prior to this time, but as a major cash crop, which butternut became in this town, it started with those men. Tobacco dropped out. Early 1960s, the market was poor. Now, a lot of farms in town continued it for a while. A few diehards continued it, but my father quit when I was a kid. I barely, as a child, remember the last crop. So he was getting into different crops. The tobacco market was soft. So he concentrated his efforts on the new crops. Now a real significant crop came along at about the time when I was a really young child, sweet corn. You know how much acres of sweet corn is grown in Hadley today? I don't have the number in my back pocket, but it's a lot. And that's a major, major cash crop in this town. And that started, when I say it started, again, somebody had some sweet corn in their garden way back, but we're talking major cash crop with acres and acres. That was back when I was a child. You had Walter Weinzick Sr., Charles Weinzick, John Zygmunt, my father, Al McKinstry was in town at that time. They started Monkey See Monkey Do around here growing sweet corn. Then it branched out. It started here in metropolitan Hadley, not in the hinterlands, North Hadley, Hockenheim, or even Hartsbrook. It was here. And why is that so significant to me? Well, a few years ago, I was reading an agricultural publication, and it stated, this is cool now, Massachusetts, nationwide, 50 states, Massachusetts is number 6. In sweet corn production. You know, think about it. Look at the map of the country. Massachusetts, the size of it, would fit as a county in some of these states like Florida, Georgia, the Carolinas. We're number 6 in sweet corn production in the whole nation, and Hadley is number 1 in Massachusetts. You know, we've set a lot of records here and a lot of innovations. Go back a few generations earlier, Hadley grew a lot of broom corn. nearly 1,000 acres. There, Hadley was famous for broom shops, brush shops. So you went from asparagus capital, well, no, let's start with broom corn capital, asparagus capital, sweet corn capital. Well, my tenure started in 1987. My father passed away. Farm passed into my hands now. Right from the start, I continued the same crops we were growing. He died at the end of April. I wasn't going to change anything. Some of it was planted. The seed was in the barn. So, okay, it was the sweet corn, the squashes, the asparagus. And then we did smaller things, beans, snap beans, that is, peas, all that kind of stuff. I continued on. Then I started my own changes, different crops, branching out. Some of my new crops, new to me, weren't new in town. Some of the ornamentals that my father never bothered with, I went into. There were a few oddball things I tried, like spaghetti squash, some crazy thing called red curry that somebody had me grow them several acres and then bought a few crates and said he couldn't sell it. That's the truth. Then I had a note of designation here. I got famous. I grew okra. It was paying big, all right? I grew it. And over at the Pioneer Valley Growers Association, which I'll talk about in a little while, one day the head salesman, Scott Danner, sitting at his desk, and I was on a delivery, handed in my paperwork, and he started laughing. He said, "Hey, Allan, I gotta tell you something I learned today. Did you know that you are the largest grower of okra in New England?" But you know, I have to tell you, at $40 a bushel in the 80s, it sounds good, but I lost money. My father used to always tell me, "I don't want you just farming with your back. I want you farming with a long, sharp pencil." Well, that's what the pencil told me. All right, 1990s. You all remember the tobacco renaissance in the valley, all right? Well, in 1992, I brought the farm back into tobacco. And, well, let's say about 6 or 7 years after my father passed, for that period, I kept the asparagus going. Started to peter out. I was getting into tobacco. There's not enough time in a day to do everything. So I'll never say never. I'm going back into asparagus, but I decided, you know what? This tobacco thing's paying. So we're going to jump on that bandwagon. And, you know, and there were other factors too. Labor. How many in this room remember picking asparagus before you went to school and they gave you a pass where you could be late without getting in trouble, right? Remember the passes? Yeah. Well, that started to go by the wayside, all right, as asparagus diminished and fewer kids were picking. So labor got to be a problem. And then there's the other thing. Remember, when my father was living, he was doing one thing while I was doing another, so we were always supervising what was happening on the farm. Well, when I was alone, you know, I have to do my herbicides early in the morning. I don't want to bleach your lawn or ornamentals white. I don't want to be off target and burn a neighbor's crop. So what I do a lot of times is get the crew out there, get them going, run away, go crop spraying, try to get back before they were done, right? Well, the days that I wasn't working on asparagus, it cost twice as much to pick it, all right? When I was there and could crack the whip, we moved along. Who here remembers Joe Red? Joe Rituba, nicknamed Joe Red, right? He could be a cantankerous old coot. None of his family's here, so I can say that, and we're going to edit that off the film. All right, well, one day I was working with the crew. Previous day, I hadn't been with them. So we're on the Aquavita field. There's about a dozen of us lined up, and we're just approaching the dirt road, finishing a set of rows. Joe comes along in his pickup, rolls the window down, and you remember how he talks. He goes, "Hey, Allan, I didn't know you're running a church here." I look at Mrs. Joe, "What do you mean?" "Yesterday when I went by, you had all statues standing in the field." So, you know, there were a lot of comments by the crew, and they waved bye to him when he drove off. Okay, so as I said, I kind of replaced tobacco with asparagus with tobacco, a new good cash crop, did a lot of good for myself and a lot of farms. You know, I'm giving this talk here tonight in Hadley. I don't feel that uncomfortable talking about tobacco, right? What do you suppose if I were over in our politically correct neighbor giving a talk tonight and I was saying nice stuff about tobacco? Is there anybody here from Amherst? Okay. Let me tell you what I think would happen. I think I'd be stoned to death by an audience that was stoned. Well, like I keep pointing out, we do these adaptations, we do these changes, and I'd like to list just a few of the really significant things we're doing on my farm and in the valley and the town around the area. First, I'll talk about value-added products. So what does that mean? That's when you peel a butternut. You don't just pick it, put it in a crate, and dump it on the market. You peel it, put it in a plastic bag. That's value-added, all right? And anybody here familiar with what I call Joe Sikowski's oodles of noodles? The guy is peeling beets, zucchini, butternut. I don't know what he's not peeling, and he's turning them into noodles for stir fry, and he's doing a booming business. He told me what his daily sales are, and I'd be breaking confidence if I told, but if you get me drunk later, maybe I'll let you know, all right? Innovations, we don't have to go far from where we're sitting right now for innovations. Go down a couple doors, you got Valley Malt. They malt barley and other grains for beer production. Now that's what I call a brand new old idea. Hadley had a malting house way back, generations ago. That sort of thing fell by the wayside. They started it up again. Well, there's new marketing methods. I mentioned the PVGA earlier, Pioneer Valley Growers Association. When I was a kid, we were totally at the mercy of markets like in Chelsea, Hartford, Springfield. We'd grow it, Barstow Trucking would bring it there, they would steal it from us and send us a little money now and then, you know? Well, in the 80s, farmers got together and they said, we're going to do something about this. Rented a warehouse, hired some office personnel, and started selling directly to the supermarkets. Now, a lot of larger farms do this anyway, but, you know, a smaller farm like mine, there is a snag. Supermarkets want volume and they want it consistent. So if I don't have enough boxes of summer squash today, they're not going to take that for an answer. So the farmers get together cooperatively. We pool our crops and distribute them to supermarkets all over the place, all over New England. Some of my butternut has gone right down to Florida. Then there's the CSA. How many people here know what a CSA is? Okay, all right. Well, I didn't. Quite a number of years ago, I learned. I got into grains, which I will talk about. And someone introduced me to a guy named Ben Lester. It was at a grain meeting. And Ben said, well, nice to meet you, Allan. He goes, I hear you're growing some grains. I'm going to be starting a grain CSA, and I want to know if you'd be interested in growing for me. Well, all right, I'm standing there, and the historian in me is going, CSA, CSA, CSA. The only CSA I could come up with is Confederate States of America. And I'm thinking, well, what, am I going to be growing wheat for the new rebel army? Well, he explained what a CSA is. You buy a share, and then you are entitled to whatever that CSA produces. So, okay, we've got several. Next barn over, down the street is a CSA. Michael Doctor operates one here. Mountain View has operated in town as a CSA. Kind of a cool concept. You buy a share, but you also take risks. You share the risk with the producer. So, okay, if I have a CSA with a variety of vegetables and my tomato crop dies early, I don't have to give the money back, all right? And that's really, really, I think, more fair than the way it is ordinarily. The people work on the CSA sometimes. You know, a lot of the people that will buy a share, kind of urban people that don't know much about things, how they grow, they want to get back to the soil. So they'll actually show up at the CSA and put in a day's work. That's another one of those things that I want to call a brand new old idea. It's brand new in some ways. In another, it's going back to a former philosophy where it's a cooperative effort. The Native Americans farmed cooperatively. When the colonists came here, they sharecropped with the Native Americans, worked together, shared the crop at the end of the field. into the season. The colonists themselves, they were individual proprietorships, but they did a lot in common. And here's something interesting about Hadley. Go to Lexington, it's the Lexington Town Green. Go to Concord, it's the Concord Town Green. Go to Hadley, it's the Hadley Common. We kept the old name. The land was held in common, and all the folks on West Street had the right to graze their cattle out there. All right, so I want to emphasize that, yes, we're progressive, we're modern, we're moving forward, but a lot of times we're just reapproaching old crops, old ideas, and kind of retrofitting them with modern technologies. Another innovation is what I call specialty crops, niche markets. We've got a perfect example in this room. D and Ray Rex, 4X Farm. All right, they do flowers. That's a specialty crop. And someone's going to say, wait a minute, we did flowers at Montgomery. Okay, yeah, okay. And that's an innovation, and they deserve a lot of credit. But right now, I'm just kind of talking about the old model farms, vegetables, tobacco, potatoes, all this stuff, doing new things. The Rexes got into flowers in their niche market, Old Hadley Flea Market. So, you know, this is cool. I think that's a really great idea. I wish I thought of it first. Oh, and you know, I think that's the most profitable use that that old haylot has ever had in its history, the flea market. All right, some of my innovations. Well, I'm going to tell you the name of a squash. And if you can remember it at the end of the meeting and you can't go to the film, you get the farm. It's called the Bobara Texicabuda. And on the market, nobody can say it, so they call it a Bobara or Bora Bora. UMass did a study. This was really good. UMass did a study of ethnic markets. They went around the state, different little ethnic enclaves, and they asked them, what did you used to get at home that you liked and you can't find here? They came up with a list of crops that will grow in New England, and that was one of them. So I grow that squash. It goes to a specialty market. You can't grow tons and tons of this stuff because the market's just too small, but they'll pay you good, you know? And I like all these little specialty niche things. Well, I'm into popcorn, dry beans, sunflower for oil. I've done the grains for beer. Spelt. Spelt is a 5,000-year-old variety of wheat. I don't think it's been spelt grown in this town since colonial times. Number of years I went into spelt, and one of my markets was V1 Vodka. That's his secret. He distills spelt, and that's where he got number one in the world quality of his vodka. And that's spelt is, you know, distilling alcohol, making beer, that goes way back. Well, maybe not. Way back. I just remember the bootlegging thing, you know, during Prohibition. Okay, throw that card out as fake news. Now, the region in the last decade saw a grain renaissance. You know, ages ago when Hadley started, they grew wheat, they grew barley, they grew all these grains. But eventually, they stopped. They take up a lot of land, that's one thing, but also the West could do it better. Bigger fields, better weather for it. You know, we can grow this stuff wonderfully in the valley, but the humidity can cause problems with disease, all right? Mycotoxins, ergot, things like that. So when the railroads got better, more developed, we just stopped. But I've gone back into it, and there's a few specialty items that I grow that I think are very interesting. My wheat is called Red Llamas. That's a very old wheat that came out of England in the early 1600s. The Pilgrims tried growing it on Cape Cod, and it just wouldn't do good in the sand. It kind of fell out of production. But UMass got a grant, did a study on wheat years ago, and they had little quantities that they planted tiny plots, the farm up near Sugarloaf, and they invited farmers, come see what we've got. And then they asked us to volunteer, if you would, to multiply it. Yeah, because when I see tiny plots, I mean tiny plots like this table, you know? So I tried several varieties, and I stuck with Red Llamas. They gave me 2 heads of seed. In the winter, I sat at the kitchen table and did that into a dish. Had about maybe a tablespoon of seed. Went out back, did this, poked it in. Did that for a number of years. If I had more markets, I would grow more, but I'm growing about 7 acres of wheat now. All right, corn, a couple of varieties that are milled into flour and meal. And just like the Red Llama, and I think I can say that as far as Red Llamas goes, I believe I'm the only person in North America growing it. I'm the person in America, via UMass, who brought it back by multiplying it. Same thing with one of my corn varieties, Plymouth Plantation. How many people have been to Plymouth Plantation? All right. You know, you got the place with the huts and the people with the funny hats like I usually wear in the summer, stuff like that, you know. Well, they also have a very modern horticultural center that's part of that, and they specialize in old variety crops, the long-haired hogs, the bighorn steers, all of that. I was over there some years ago just telling them what we're doing in the valley with the grains, just to get some input from the horticultural center, since we are into, like I said, the heritage grains. And, you know, they were really nice to me. Director went over to a cabinet, brought out 2 ears of corn that were very unusual and gave them to me. I don't know how he did this, but UMass Waltham worked with Plymouth Plantation. They bred backwards. They took descendant stock and bred backwards, and Dennis Cullinane probably could tell us how they did that, but not now, okay? I'll keep you here to breakfast. We don't need you to keep us here to lunch. But anyway, they came up with the corn that the Pilgrims were growing, I mean the Indians were growing on the coast when the Pilgrims arrived. It's a very narrow ear with 8 rows of kernels. It's a flint, and it's multicolored, kind of like the ornamental corn. It didn't have a name. So they kept saying, well, the Plymouth 8-row. And I says, hey, let's call it Plymouth Flint. I said, okay, we'll do that. So now it's got a name. Again, I think I'm the only person growing it commercially. I've got acres of it. I think the Wampanoag Indians on Cape Cod are growing some for themselves. But I got a few rare things there. And the markets are interesting. I supply a number of bakeries in the area and even out of state. The Pioneer Valley Heritage Grains, the CSA, the rebel people that I thought I was going to be growing for an army. I'm growing a lot of grain for them. And one of the most interesting markets I have is Plymouth Plantation itself. In the center of the town of Plymouth, there's a very old grist mill. It's the oldest in North America. It's been operating since the 1640s. And they bought it. And they turned it into a museum. So when you go there, you buy a ticket. They bring you in, they give you a little tour of the mill, the miller does a demonstration, and they have a small store as part of the mill, and they are selling cornmeal and wheat from my grains, and advertising it as such. See, the old history student wanted to make that diploma pay at least a little. So I did come up with an idea to target these historic places with a historic product. Look, if you're over at Cape Cod, you're interested in history, you go to a restaurant, well, you could order a corn muffin, you could order bread or rolls, but when they tell you on the menu, this is the corn the Indians and Pilgrims grew, this is the wheat the Pilgrims grew, now you buy 2, you know? So I did sell an idea, and Plymouth was down recently picking up a load. They want me there Saturday. You're going to have a conference. They want to have growers meet buyers, and they told me, they were all excited. They said there is, I don't remember the name, but there's some fancy restaurant in New York City. The owner is going to be there and wants to meet me because he's crazy about my corn. Well, I'm going to maybe start abbreviating some of this. touch on some of the challenges. I mean, we do have challenges that our grandparents, parents, and previous generations had, and some of them they didn't have. Interestingly enough, federal government did a study of every profession in this country, from air traffic controller and brain surgeon right down to the Moonies selling roses on the street corner. They said that agriculture, farming, is in the top 10 of stress. And I can tell you they're right. Some of our stressors. Well, one that's kind of always been around, financial. You know, the cost of production, the cost of living is skyrocketing, and our prices aren't keeping pace. Now, don't go say to my buyers that I said they're all bums and none of them pay me fairly. That's not true, but, you know, when you move a lot of stuff to the supermarket chain stores, you're grateful that they'll take a volume, but they're rock-bottom prices, and it just doesn't cut it, you know? Urbanization. Hadley's experiencing urbanization. We're farming in backyards now. We're using pesticides. We're making noise early and late. We're making dust. We're making odors. You've got the new folks with urban mentalities, and I'm right in the backyard at 5 in the morning doing this stuff. Most of them have been pretty nice, but we got to kind of learn to cooperate and coexist. Traffic. Oh, my God. Grandpa and Daddy didn't have this problem. You know, it's dangerous, and it's determining what we do, when we do it, where we do it. I've crossed Route 9 midday to go spray out on Honeypot. I don't know how I got across Route 9, but I got across Route 9. Got the cemetery road and turned around and went home because the traffic was backed up to the cemetery. Cross path road to Route 9, and I'm not going to sit on the dike with 400 gallons in the tank and clutching and, you know, forget it. So traffic's a big problem. Labor. Well, okay, I got to be careful now. Pat Keegan's here. He worked for me. Darn good kid. All right. You can still get good help. Dependable, hardworking, but it's just hard to get enough. Generally, in a given season, I have 20 people on the payroll, and not all 20 of them are good help, right? A lot of them are, and we won't name names, but some of them aren't, and they're harder to get. Another problem, importing produce from faraway places. They've gotten good at it, all right? You can eat asparagus in January now. When we were growing up, I remember the last day of asparagus picking, my father would say, eat up and enjoy it because you're not going to see it again until next year, that sort of thing, you know? Well, it's a troublesome thing. You know, we're in Butternut Squash Valley, and I'm thinking of just one season in particular where we had bumper crop. And, I mean, we can hardly get rid of the stuff. I go to some of the local supermarkets way before we sold out our crop, and what's there? Butternut squash on the counter. This sticker says Honduras. That says Guatemala. You know, they're driving our prices down. They're glutting the market, and it's not fair because those products are produced in places where people work for nothing, and they have almost nothing for regulations. And that's another one of the big problems. I'm not saying we shouldn't have any regulations. That's not realistic. Labor, chemicals, you gotta police it. But anyone in farming in this room, my God, you have no idea what the regulations are like. My father couldn't even have envisioned this. It's putting some of us out of business. Tremendous regulations, unrealistic regulations. Food safety sounds like a great idea, doesn't it? Okay. Pick up a squash that's been growing on the ground for months, put it in a container. Now it's illegal to let that container touch the ground. Pick an ear of corn that the birds might have been sitting on when you showed up at the field, put them on a wagon. Now legally you cover that load on the right end because a bird might poop on it. I mean, a deer walks through your field or a woodchuck. You get out there and you flag that trail 5 feet to the left, 5 feet to the right, and don't pick anything in it. So if several deer walk down your 600-yard field, you know, this is what, and the paperwork that goes with it, there's no time to farm anymore, or I gotta hire a secretary or something. You know, the record keeping's unbelievable. Global weather changes, I guess I don't even have to hardly talk about that. There was always crazy weather in New England, now it's a roller coaster ride. Extremes are par for the course, it's very difficult for us. But I will say one funny thing, even though this global weather thing and the storms and all the crazy stuff we're facing now all the time, most of it's bad, but not 100%. Long warm falls now. We got a lot more time to pick the squash and do fall crops before they freeze. You never saw that. Even when I was growing up, we tried to get the squash picked before the three-county fair ended because you had frost. Now we're going forever out there. One of these times we're going to get burnt, all right? We're getting used to it. You know, there's one very sharp, astute North Hadley farmer, and I probably shouldn't name his name, but he's a smart one. And he said to me, you know, Allan, I always vote Republican because they gave us 3 to 4 weeks longer to pick the squash now before it freezes. And we were talking, and he says, hey, do you suppose the Trump administration will stretch that to 5 weeks? All right, disease and insects, you know all that. You know, a lot of you saw asparagus go down from fusarium. Now we're seeing squash, pumpkins, and other vegetables go down from Phytophthora capsaicin, something straight from hell. The devil invented it, believe me. And we're using new technologies to adjust to all these changes. Integrated pest management. Right around and look at the cornfield. Sometimes you see what looks like a butterfly net in the field. We hire a scout. He puts a pheromone in that. Monitors the flights of moths and gives us recommendations. There have been times when I have harvested sweet corn and never sprayed the field once. Because his monitoring showed I didn't have to. There were other times when I might have sprayed it once a week, and he told me, get out there every 3 days or you're going to lose it. So that's one of the new technologies. I did something that worked and didn't work. I did it for a few years, gave it up. Trichogramma wasps. Tiny wasps from China. And we'd release them in the cornfields, and they would parasitize the eggs from the moths, lay the eggs that turn into the earworm. It worked sometimes. Sometimes I got wormy corn. And among us farmers, we got a little joke. The wormy wave. We go like this to one another. You don't want to see that too much, you know? A lot of new equipment out there. There's something called a zone builder. I don't have a picture of it. It'd take too long to really explain it. But it's a no-till vegetable farming. It really gives you good drainage for disease control. It's great for soil structure, building it up. So we are into a lot of new technologies with a lot of old ideas. Good philosophy that I live by. Don't fight nature. Work in harmony with it. We're part of a greater whole. You know, on my farm, we are changing, just like the other farms, changing with the times. But it's that paradoxical change again, reapproaching old ideas and just retrofitting them. Well, we're going to skip a couple of these because we got a few pictures to show. Okay, we'll skip a whole bunch of these actually. I was going to give a plug on history, so maybe I'd better because this is the Historical Society. All right, I've mentioned so many historical products and methods that we're going back to in our own way. So, you know, history is cyclical. I mean, pay attention to what I've been saying. The crops go away, the crops come back. Concepts go away, concepts come back. Taper haircuts go away, come back. So the story of my farm is pretty much a story that's just held in common in this town. It's a lot of hard work, careful thinking, perseverance, innovation. That's characterized the farms in this town right from the start. And if you're going to survive, that's what it takes. And you know, just think of some of the accomplishments of this town. I mean, I could stand here till breakfast, but you know, broom corn capital, asparagus capital, sweet corn capital, Levi Stockbridge helping to found UMass, the things that the farmers have accomplished in this town. You know, I kind of think that Hadley has boasting rights, but down on the farm, that's not our mindset. We're out there, we're doing our job, we're doing our duty, we're doing our best, but if I were to boast, now we're going to have a little fun to end up. If I were to boast, it sounds something like this. I say that Hadley's innovative, hardworking farmers will always distinguish Hadley as a noteworthy capital. I guarantee you, my fellow citizens, that Hadley's farmers, which are the best in the world, the best, will always make Hadley great again. My brother Mark worked hard on this, put together a few pictures. It's not very long, but it just kind of puts some flesh to the bones. Then we can have some questions, answers, comments, whatever. Go ahead, Mark.
Okay. Just a few comments. I did grow up on the farm. I worked for defense contractors for the past 30 years, and so I get to be the happy uncle that visits the farm and takes pictures and films. Imagine, Mr. Rex, how it is when you're trying to pick corn and somebody wants to start filming the crew and hold that pose. But Allan is really great, and he's a hard worker, and he's patient. He's got good patience with the crew, and he's good to them, and he's been good to me.
Most of the time, right, Pat?
So I've got some photos, and it was kind of cute because Rosalie sent me an email. She's a cousin. And she said, do you have any pictures of the farm? And I said, send them to me three at a time. Well, I've been doing this for 10 years now since I got my digital camera. I file them by year, and in each year is each by day. I had 34 folders with about 100 photos in each and videos. So I went through it, and I've come, got it down to a few photos. I never intended it for this. I like to send them all over the country to family and friends. So a little grainy, the camera's 10 years old. But I divided it into three categories. There's heritage, we'll start with the grandparents who passed the farm down to Dad, down to Allan. And then there's going to be homestead, some shots of the house and farm, and then horticulture, the crops that we grow. Okay, and this is the part that I think Allan thought was going to crash, because I have a battery-powered computer, but here we go.
Best documented farm in Hadley, but we'll finish before breakfast, I promise.
So we start with the grandparents. We have Helena. She was born in 1876, died in 1949. And Alexander, born in 1883, died in 1946. And I point that out. I'm not going to take long, but I want to say something. Alan mentioned early in the talk how he's indebted to them. And the sad thing is we really never knew him, because we were born in the 50s.
Right.
And these people worked hard when Mom and Dad were the youngest of big families, so you have grandparents who never knew. Okay. Then we go into... That's Dad bunching asparagus, and he went into Applebee's in Hadley. That was a shot you saw over the door. You got Dad and Alan working on butternut squash. We grew 5,000 crates of that. That's what I spent instead of playing soccer. Oh, I wanted to play soccer. We were cooking squash. The butternut squash. This was the homestead back in the 80s. And now... Just some shots in the yard. Out behind the barns, we got the sweet corn growing.
That's that home lot structure that I talked about.
Picking squash, some of the crops. Summer squash on the left, zucchini on the right. Summer squash. Want to talk about the plastic?
Well, there's some of our new technologies. Not that new, but that's how we get the 4th of July corn. Planted under the plastic.
And you can see some of the corn is starting to come up.
Yeah.
When it turns 90, you better split it open, and we did.
Yeah.
And then later it's a very dirty job pulling up that plastic. And then I just have some shots of the corn and the silk. Each one of those silks goes to a kernel on the cob. I don't know if people know that. And the tassel fertilizes it.
There's your IPM. We're trapping the moths, then I know what to spray.
Crew getting ready to go pick corn.
Some of the good ones.
I got some videos in here. The picture's worth a thousand words. What's a video?
They were there that day for the... They were there that day.
Yeah.
So I'm riding a tractor in
that high speed.
That's one of the ways it's done.
And then they're packing it.
That's illegal there. We don't have a tarp on the ground, but the rules... The rules didn't exist that day, all right?
There's the boss, Logan. Some of the corn, boy, wouldn't you like a year today?
Right now, right off the field.
Pumpkin patch, and then they're doing some picking here. Hand them up. This out of Honeypot Meadow, and then we drive the load in. And like Alan said, driving on that cemetery road with the traffic, it's tough.
Try to cross Route 9.
Cleaning up the pumpkins.
Some wheat.
Hopkins Academy in the back there. Wheat.
There's the harvest.
He drives that at 2 in the morning, doesn't he, down Route 9?
No, he kind of does what he does because they take that head off and run on a long trailer.
Okay. That's it. Okay.
We're hauling spelt there. Spelt's different than regular wheat. Grows with a clunky husk on it. We're running it through a machine that takes that off. Dirty, dirty job. Never liked doing it.
Oh, that's the husks. Outside,
yeah, the husks.
Videos are short so that I can email to people.
Yeah.
Oops, sorry. Go on to the next one.
Now that's wheat going through a cleaner that takes the chaff out of it. That's the good stuff coming out into the bucket. That's where the dirty stuff goes in. Then there's a screening system, and it'll just take out all the straw and whatever. Beetles,
Did you buy that equipment or did you rent?
Well, that one I'm going to make the guy an offer. I had a deal where if I store it, I can use it, but I don't think he's going to grow grain anymore. I didn't buy the combine. That'll be the next generation. Sunflowers for oil. That deal didn't work too good, but I tried. It was pretty anyway.
It was pretty.
I could have made money selling tickets to take pictures.
In fact, with the high school back there, you wouldn't believe how many kids had their yearbook picture taken. And
yeah.
I talked to Tom Pitt. I want to give him credit for an upcoming photo here. He was over at the select board meeting. But yeah, he took a picture of a lot of kids in the fields for the sunflowers. And he's got, these are shots I took. That's his shot. I love that shot.
Tobacco.
So they're softening the ground so they can pull the plants to transplant the tobacco.
There we are.
Was that wrapper tobacco?
Yes, wrapper tobacco, yeah.
And then that's the planting machine, the water tank up there, and well, you'll see how we use it in 1 second, right here.
Yeah, that's different than the grandfather's time, or even parents' time.
So there, here's a shot of...
That's the best machine right there, I'm telling you right now. There's different designs, that's the best, that's it.
And you could do like cabbage and stuff.
Oh yeah, you could do a lot of things with that machine. Yeah.
And then just a month after they planted it, I put a quarter near it, and then a couple months, bigger. Tommy?
Yeah.
Okay. Just the tobacco shed.
Yes, it's different operations.
You know, I just want to drop back because it's amazing the ingenuity of these people. See those boards here? There's a linkage there. So you unhook a hook and you push up and all the slats come up to aerate the barn without having to put a ladder.
That's kind of a Hadley thing.
And I have a shot that was intended to be for the pumpkins, but I realized that it shows the barn open on the end there.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they pushed on that linkage and it opened. And also these open this way.
Yeah, that's Connecticut style.
And the barn over there,
the other way.
I'll pull into the picture. Yeah, it's the other way.
Oh, every day at night. You know, when I have sheds at this
one. This one's faster. Because you see the board across and you just lift and a bunch of them come at a time. Okay. And then Allan Chapin.
Yeah, see, of the farmers here, this is proof that I work.
It was a screenshot.
This is also August 11th, 2007. Yeah. Actually, it is. I have the datum. And then...
Oh, that's the crop, believe me.
Big leaves. You know, Danny Weinzick, his mom, Cindy, works at the post office. He's spearing them up. Yeah. So you put like a spearhead on the, like a yard.
They get it, Mark. They get it.
Okay.
They've done it.
Yeah.
There's just showing four of them on a lap. Then we got the parallel beams and they hang them, haul them into the barn.
Did all the jobs. 47 chopping was my job.
And then they're going to hang it. Allan's at the top, by the way. That's because these boards are not nailed down.
Yeah, I've also fallen and ended up in the hospital before.
Yeah. So learn by your mistakes, right?
A lot of people have done that.
Right here.
Did you? You fall?
Got a broken ankle.
I crack ribs. It's just not nice.
And you let sunflower to go to seed, right?
I'm going to keep the seed. Select some nice plants.
Pretty flower.
Yeah, beautiful smelling.
This is the big enemy of tobacco.
Yeah, that's the hail from when we had the big tornado down in Springfield. That's not a joke. That's what my father didn't see that. My grandfather didn't see that. That's hail. Last time you saw that was in Egypt at the Exodus. Very historic.
June 1st, 2011, when the tornado ripped through Springfield, Allan picked that up 20 miles north of there, and he froze it so I could get some shots. And that's all I had for folks.
That's good. All right. You know, if you have any questions,
I'll
I'll do my best to give you some fake news and alternative facts. Anything? We were too thorough.
Yeah, I just moved up from Windsor.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, yeah.
I just moved up from Windsor.
Oh boy, tobacco country.
Tobacco country was. And somebody said that somebody stole the seeds and moved them to Ecuador, somewhere warm. And that's why there's no shade tobacco.
You know, I don't think the seed was stolen. The only stealing that I know is in, you've got the tobacco experiment station in Connecticut. And Jim Almandia, excellent scientist, diplomatic immunity, attaché case, brought us some Havana 2000, which was disease resistant. It's the only caper I know on tobacco. Your story, I'm not familiar with it, really could be true, but I don't know anything about that problem. Yes?
How did that farm get its name? Why is it called the Z-Acres?
That's a really good question.
Seems like you work hard.
Okay. Pay attention to the names of the farms around here. Do you know how many farms in this town end in O-W-S-K-I-I-C-Z? My father told me, because I asked him that once when I was a kid. He says, you know...
I know one that doesn't.
Oh. Security, get him out of here. He's a loser. Get him out of here. It's not lazy people. It's that pastoral scene of rolling lazy land. But what my father told me, he says, you know, when you get outside of Hadley on the markets in Chelsea or wherever, I think they have a hard time with those names and remembering them. So he said, I chose something they could remember.
Yeah, that's true.
And pronounce.
Gleaning. Are people allowed on the fields after you harvest?
That is a farm-by-farm sort of thing. I mean... I've had some really interesting gleaning. The folk from Cambodia like to pick my corn after we're done picking it. And they're willing to pay me, but I always tell them, cook me something. And they cook me the most fantastic things, you know. It really is an individual farm thing, but it really is better to get permission, you know.
I don't want to steal this show, but Dad, we raised butternut squash, and in the 70s, they have a blemish on them, and you couldn't sell them. That's before people chucked them up in a lathe and peeled them. So we were all done harvesting, and you go out to the field. My dad drove out, and there's thousands of squash left on the field. And there was this man who had his trunk open, and he was throwing the squash in, and Dad comes out, and he helped them load the trunk. And he goes, boy, this farmer left a lot of squash, and you see, do you mind if I pick some? And Dad says, no, and he's loading them up. And then he saw this vehicle coming. He goes, that's the farmer, and he carries a shotgun. And the guys skedaddled out.
They both took off, spinning their tires. Oh, you know, there's one thing I want to mention. We're talking about innovations and Hadley's pride and everything. Steve Wildes here. His father developed the nicest ornamental corn there is. And better than mine, all right? And I've grown his. And it's called Wildes Pride, and it's in the seed catalogs today. Okay? Got about that, Steve? All right. Anything else? Yes?
The wheat that you grow, you called it an ancient...
Red Lamas.
Oh, ancient.
Well, let's put it this way. The spelt is 5,000 years old. The Red Lamas is not that old, but it was something they did in medieval Europe.
So has it been...
No, it hasn't been changed.
Okay. Because, you know, they talk about gluten-free,
yeah,
and that the older wheats are good for people who eat gluten-free.
That's true, so... but they still have gluten. They do.
What about the protein?
Well, that's a year-by-year thing, but they do score good on protein. You know, modern stuff is bred to feed a hungry world. The older stuff is high quality, and that's why these high-end bakeries ask me to grow it. It's extremely good flavor. The yields aren't that great.
By the way, we have a loaf of bread.
All right, we're going to sample it, too. Yeah.
To sample.
Yes.
Made from Red Lamas.
Yeah.
Year-round farming. Is there a growth in greenhouses?
Yeah,
or?
There is, but I don't want it. You know, I'm modern and progressive in many ways, but in some ways I'm old-fashioned like my good neighbor Ray Rex. This is our philosophy. Farm with the seasons, harvest it, sell it, close shop, go hunting and ice fishing. Anything else? Yeah?
Did you raise cucumbers?
Yeah, when I was a kid, my father raised them. Maybe I should grow them now, but who's going to pick them?
We had the pickling and the lawn.
Yeah. Who's going to pick them? You know, Pat,
you want to pick cukes?
Okay. There's your answer.
He's 6'6". It's a long way to the
Yeah, that's not fair with him, all right? All right, anything else? Mr. Kelly? No? Oh, you're just nervously tapping your... It's over. Don't worry, we're done.
Thank you very much.
All right.